Beneath the surface of each of the Great Lakes lay mysteries and marvels of all kinds, but a particularly tantalizing one might just be a sixth Great Lake. Jill Heinerth is a world-renowned cave diver, explorer, and author of Into the Planet, One Woman's Journey to Find Herself, and she joins us now from the Great Lakes Public Forum underway in Niagara Falls, Ontario, to explain. Welcome to the program.
Thank you. It's nice to be with you.
Now, Jill, your job takes place in the fascinating underwater world that most of us don't get to experience, and it's not just for recreational purposes. This is your job. What is it like to do cave diving as a profession?
Mm-hmm. Well, I like to tell people that I'm literally swimming through the veins of Mother Earth. So I'm in these water-filled passages beneath your feet. And I know that terrifies most people, but it's a remarkable environment, like a museum of natural history.
Very nice. Now, last night, we spoke to the filmmakers about the documentary Great Lakes Untamed, and you were part of that project. Here is a clip of you diving into the Ottawa River.
I'm eternally curious, but I want my efforts and the risks that I take underwater to have value, value for society, value for scientists.
So, of course, that was the Ottawa River, many consider the sixth Great Lake. What exactly were you looking for and what did you find?
Well, in the Ottawa River, we have Canada's longest underwater cave system with over 10.6 kilometers of passageways that go underneath Ontario and Quebec. And inside there is the densest population of life I have ever seen in a freshwater cave. So there are some remarkable mussels, these filter feeding organisms that are endangered and really important for us to learn about because of the services that they provide to the ecosystem.
You talk about those mussels. Why is it important when we talk about filtering water and sort of the health of our Great Lakes and other waterways?
Mm-hmm. Well, a mussel, a native mussel, will filter like 1 to 2 liters per hour for its entire life. And some mussels can live 1 to 200 years. So you can imagine how important that filtration service is because they can be, you know, filtering out things like E. coli or even flame retardants, things that we don't want in our water. And in the Ottawa River, I'm working in a place that will serve the St. Lawrence River and all the way out to the ocean. And we just have to remember that all of these systems are connected. And what we do on the surface of the earth over here may be returned to us to drink over there. So it's all interconnected.
Now, you've dived inside icebergs, active volcanoes, and even under the Sahara Desert. And I think, a lot of people don't have this appreciation or understanding of how important the Great Lakes are. I want to get a better understanding. You've said that it's been incredibly special to be part of this particular project. How so?
Oh, it's really important to me. I grew up in the Great Lakes. I learned to dive in the Great Lakes. And when I was a child, things were different. I mean, I used to sneak through a fence in order to access the beach and the water in Lake Ontario, a fence that said no trespassing, that was, blocking access to a shared resource. And when I walked on the beach as a child, it was covered in drying dead fish. I mean, so things are better now than they were when I was a child, but we still have a long way to go. And that's going to come through making like personal connections with the water like I have. Like when we love it, we want to protect it.
Tell us about that. What is it that Canadians can do in order to connect with the waterways and the Great Lakes and ultimately for the health of the lakes itself?
Well, you don't have to be a diver, but if you are, there's over 30,000 shipwrecks that have gone missing in the Great Lakes. We know of the location of literally thousands of shipwrecks that people can dive on and see a little bit of our historic past. But there's also great abundance in biological species to observe underwater. And if you're not a diver, you can snorkel, swim, paddle, and do anything to enjoy the water, even if it's just strolling along the waterfront and enjoying the view. It is the essence of life. And when we spend time near, on, or under the water, it definitely relaxes the soul. It's a really good antidote to stress.
What do you hope in terms of some of the personal discoveries that you're making and your team is making? What do you hope Canadians take away from the discoveries in our lakes and rivers?
Well, you know, I do have to take risks, significant risks, to do the kind of work that I do. But it has to be worth it for me. It's important for me to come back with images, video, you know, educational material that I can share with others so that they can also understand and get connected to these important resources. And I think if there was one message that I wanted to leave with people, it's like, you know, we've all experienced COVID over the last couple of years, and that has given us an idea about how humanity is all interconnected. I mean, I could hold all the COVID virus in my hand, right? And yet it's affected everybody on the planet. Well, we need to understand that the same is true for water. You know, even if you live in, you know, the middle of Ontario and you're far from a shoreline of the Great Lakes, you know, what you do on the surface of the land still affects the watershed. It soaks into the ground and can be transmitted through groundwater systems like the ones that I swim through. So it's those interconnections that I think are so important for us to embrace.
I am really curious, you know, you talk about, you know, the risks that you have to take. Is it worth it to go into these underwater caves? I want to sort of pick your brain. What's some of the most memorable caves that you have gone into personally? Like, I'm thinking when you close your eyes, you probably still see some of these visions and sort of pathways that you are sort of diving and navigating in. What's one of the most memorable ones you have?
I mean, some places that I dive, some underwater cave systems are like literally like crystal palaces. They're so stunningly beautiful with clear water. Now, I'll be the first to tell you that the Ottawa River caves are not that. I mean, there is no delicate speleothems and formations that are beautiful. In fact, the water is dark red, stained by the trees, basically by tannins. It's like tea, you know, the water's fast. There's a lot of silt and it's difficult. And so it's not going to attract many, if any, cave divers, certainly no one who's looking for something quote unquote beautiful. But to me, the life within that cave is beautiful to see, literally at times, like 100 filter feeding mussels in a square meter doing their job, you know, keeping our river and the watershed clean. That's beautiful to me.
So we talk about the beautiful side of it all, but of course there are some dangers, some obvious dangers, of course. You talk mm-hmm. about it as being a very dangerous sport. You've mentioned that you've lost over 100 friends and colleagues from accidents in underwater caves. What keeps you going?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's no question that cave diving is incredibly dangerous and it should be reserved only for people with the right equipment, training, and background. I would never, ever encourage anyone to cave dive unless, you know, they take that level of dedication. But, you know, when you do have the training and the equipment and are on a meaningful mission like this, it's incredibly rewarding to, you know, share images from places that nobody else will ever see. Like, I've literally had the chance to go where no one's gone before and bring back those images. And that's really rewarding for me.
Something that I've read that you've said is that, you know, fear keeps you safe. Can you walk us through that a little bit? When you're underwater, what does that actually mean?
Well, you know, people just assume that I'm fearless because I go into these places where my friends have gone to die, literally, you know, but I believe that fear guides the way for us. You know, when we are willing to step into the darkness and let our eyes adjust to the light, then that gives us an opportunity to stand on the threshold of discovery, to do something that's new for us or maybe new for humanity. So I am not fearless. I'm scared every time I go diving, and I want to dive with people that are afraid. So, you know, we look to the populace right now, people are afraid of a lot of things. They're afraid of the big issues that we face, and water issues and climate change and everything else. But I say, embrace the fear, step into it, and push yourself into that uncomfortable place where you have an opportunity for discovery. You have an opportunity to be an explorer.
You talk about issues. Something that you've sort of experienced in your 30-year career is that, you know, cave diving, there aren't a lot of women in this industry. It is a highly male-dominated profession. How has that affected your career?
Well, it hasn't always been easy. I mean, certainly as a little girl, when I envisioned this career, there was no one that looked like me that I could look up to. There are more and more women getting into technical diving, cave diving, cinematography underwater, and that's really exciting for me to see. But yeah, it was tough. I mean, I faced both, you know, unintentional sexism, but as well as you know, quite overt sexism. So it's been a struggle at times, a struggle to create an independent career in a profession that not many people see as a profession is challenging. But I have an innate belief that anything is possible when we put our hearts and minds and work hard.
Now, you've recently published a memoir titled Into the Planet. Tell us more. What is the takeaway here for readers?
Well, Into the Planet covers my life as an underwater explorer and some of the incredible things I've seen from inside Antarctic icebergs to underneath the Sahara Desert. But really, the book is more about, you know, facing and embracing fear and big challenges in life. And so maybe there's a little bit of self-help in there, but I think people will be moved with a bit of inspiration from the lessons I've taken from my adventures around the world.
As you've talked about, you know, the underwater world is full of wonders and mysteries, but its ecosystems and species are vulnerable to climate change and human impact. I am curious, have you noticed these changes over the while, you know, while cave diving?
Mm-hmm. Oh, absolutely. I mean, you know, in my life, I'm in my late 50s. I shouldn't have seen so much change in the natural world and in our waterways as what I've seen in my lifetime. So I've seen everything from, you know, coral bleaching in the oceans to springs that no longer flow because of the loss of volume in the aquifer to, you know, degradation of water bodies. In the Great Lakes, I was able to dive the lakes before zebra mussels covered all of the wrecks. But an invasive zebra mussel came in from the Caspian Sea and has really changed the entire biology of the lakes. But this region that I'm working in, where the caves are in the Ottawa River, are still free of zebra mussels. So we're very careful not to accidentally transport them there. But it is a little bit of an incubator place that allows us to see what the lakes were and what they could be again if we can control the invasive species.
I'm curious to know, you know, not everyone is going to maybe suit up and start going cave diving. It may not be for them, but a combination of citizen science and sort of underwater research. I'm curious, how can that be part of the solution to addressing those challenges?
Oh, there are ways for everybody to get involved in protecting their local waterways as citizen scientists, you know, helping in water sampling activities or other things, but even just cleaning up their local water body and getting connected in that manner. So I think citizen science and outreach is an incredibly important part of solving very pressing issues. I mean, when we think about academia, we don't necessarily have the time on our side to go through some of these traditional research publication and peer review efforts when we've got water and climate change issues that are like very, very dire. So citizen scientists can help us speed up that process and create a body of research and, you know, eyes on the water that can help.
Jill, really fascinating stuff. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
The Agenda with Steve Paikin is made possible through generous philanthropic contributions from viewers like you. Thank you for supporting TVO's journalism.